said this was the only application.
Okay, good morning, everybody. Go ahead and call the meeting to order. And I want to mention that this is the first time in a long time that we have an entire board here. So that's great. Anyway, Sheila, would you please call the roll?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ron Lieberman?
Here.
Latasha Green Cobb?
Present.
Ryan Benson?
Here.
Sandra Einhorn?
Here.
Mario Ficella?
Here.
Bill Gulliford?
Here.
Dev Matwani?
Here.
Holly Rashine?
Here.
And Adam Calloway?
Here.
Thank you. If I can please remind everybody, speak up. Court reporter Brooke is, you know, it's the first time she's doing one of our meetings, so just speak clearly and she won't have any problem. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Trey?
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members. It's great to be here in St. Petersburg, and we have always tried to accommodate for local leaders to address us when we come to their cities and towns. And we have the pleasure of introducing the St. Petersburg mayor and a former member of the legislature that we have worked with in the past, and that's Mayor Rick Kreisman. So we recognize you, Mayor Kreisman. Thank you for coming. Yeah, if you'd like to. please make a few comments.
Well, thank you very much, and good morning, and welcome to the Sunshine City. Chair Lieberman, Vice Chair Green-Cobb, members of the Florida Housing Board of Directors, thank you for being here in St. Petersburg today. It will likely come as no surprise to any of you that the number one issue that I hear about is housing affordability. You notice I'm saying housing affordability, not affordable housing. And I'm doing that because it seems like everyone has a different definition of what is affordable housing, and the term itself often carries a negative connotation. That's why I prefer to use the term housing affordability. And everyone can agree that we need housing that is affordable for everyone at all income brackets, from low income to low income to workforce to family housing. And people ask me about housing affordability and workforce housing more than any other issue facing our city, and it's truthfully not even close. I love my city, but I'm under no illusion that we don't face the same challenge with affordability that so many other cities around Florida and around the nation are facing. It's why I created our For All, From All housing affordability plan. We want to create and preserve 2,400 multifamily units over a 10-year period. Our plan supports the development of 200 non-subsidized workforce density bonus units. We will support the construction of 300 accessory dwelling units, such as encouraging developers to include affordable units like carriage houses and garage apartments, and that's really just a start. We're also getting $45 million in American Rescue Plan dollars from the Biden administration, and when we asked our citizens what their number one priority was for where the city should spend a big chunk of that money, we heard them loud and clear: create housing that's affordable. All of this is just a start. And we have an election in a couple of months, and there will be a new mayor in January here in St. Petersburg, and this has to be that person's biggest priority too. So I want to say thank you to all of you on the board and everyone in this room for being here in St. Petersburg. Your being here shines a light on our need for smart, thoughtful solutions to housing affordability challenges. And I know that you all have serious work to tackle here today, because I've seen your agenda. But I do hope that each of you will take some time to enjoy St. Pete. You're just about within walking distance to our new award-winning St. Pete Pier, voted by the readers of USA Today as the second best new destination for 2020 in the country, and certainly one of my favorite places in the city. You're also within a 10-minute walk of 6 world-class museums, including the Dali Museum and the recently opened Museum of American Arts and Crafts Movement, which is a 137,000 square foot museum, which is the only museum in the world dedicated exclusively to the American Arts and Crafts Movement. Or just explore our downtown, and I think you'll see why visitors are flocking to the Sunshine City from all around the world. Again, I want to thank each and every one of you for what you do for the citizens of St. Petersburg and the state of Florida, and I want to thank you all for being here today. Thank you.
Welcome. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Excuse me, Ron, can I just say something else? To the folks that are listening on the phone, if y'all could please mute your lines so that we don't get any of your what's going on in your world here in the meeting. Thank you.
Thank you. Anything else?
Yep, I didn't know if there were any other elected officials that we needed to recognize before the meeting. And there may be some that come in and we can recognize them at the end.
Yep. But, she scooted out.
Oh, she did. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, there's another chance at the end of the meeting, so.
She's waving.
Okay, and I'm sorry.
Commissioner.
Oh, I'm sorry. I don't know who she is. I can't see that far back.
He's asking you to introduce yourself.
Yes. Yeah, Commissioner, if you want to come forward, I'm sorry.
Get in the back. Well, I wasn't prepared to speak, but I too want to welcome you to Pinellas County. I'm Pat Gerard, Pinellas County Commissioner. I'm in my second term, and we're working very hard on affordable housing in Pinellas County. We partner with many of you in the room, and looking forward to that with our local option sales tax. We've set aside quite a bit of money in the next 10 years dedicated to affordable housing. And we'll probably be looking at our ARPA funds to do some more. So huge need, as the mayor said, and so we're looking forward to what we can do. You know, it's a never-ending battle trying to get enough, but thanks for being here.
Okay. Thank you, Commissioner.
Yep, thank you. That might be it. That's all the public comment that I know of. I think.
Okay.
I think Board Member Einhorn may want to make a point.
Yep. Sandra.
Yep. Thank you. I just wanted to publicly acknowledge Trey and staff. Every quarter, there is a performance dashboard by which they are all judged by that goes to DEO. And I am pleased to report for anyone that didn't see it in the informational items that everything is green, aka good to go. It's not the easiest of times. I know that folks are still working remotely at times, and so kudos again to Trey and staff for a completely good to go performance dashboard this quarter.
Thank you, Sandra. I'll say that it is a team effort. There are a lot of folks. I know Bill Aldinger's shop heads up a lot of that, as well as Chris Hurst's shop. And so it's a team effort. And we, of course, work with DEO and appreciate their help with that as well. And it's great news. So thank you for your recognition.
And Trey, may I add, Bill, I'm probably his least favorite board member right now. He put together a presentation for me for my Rotary Club, and it was amazing. And I got some questions that I actually couldn't answer. But so that's a good thing. And I just want to thank you and the staff as well.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, it's time for any public comment on anything that's on the agenda. Okay, I don't see anyone, so let's continue. Okay, I need a motion on the minutes.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Okay. Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. Approval of items on the consent agenda. First of all, is there any items that the board might want to pull?
Chair, I do have three items.
Okay.
Multifamily C, D, and E. They're on corresponding pages 50, 52, and 53.
Okay, what were those again? Could you?
Multifamily C, D, and E. Is that? Okay.
C, D, and E. Does
50, 52, and 54.
Okay.
Okay.
Any other board member have anything? Okay, I need a motion to approve the consent agenda, less those items.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Okay. Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
So then we'll go, Mr. Chairman, if I may,
yes.
We'll go immediately to the consent items that were not approved.
Okay.
So the first is multifamily bonds, consent item C, request approval of credit underwriting update letter to increase the MMRN amount, et cetera, et cetera. And so we'll...
We'll take one at a time then.
Yep, one at a time, I think.
Okay.
Okay.
All right, I need a motion and a second to go to discussion.
Motion.
Motion for discussion?
Second.
Motion on approval, I'm sorry. Motion to approve item C, and then we'll have discussion. Is that the way to go, Hugh?
That would be appropriate, yes.
Okay.
That was my motion.
Okay. I have a motion and
okay.
A second.
I'll second.
Okay, a motion and a second. Now discussion. Okay. Tasha?
Do we have a representative from the principal here? I just have a question in terms of how the property will be managed.
To make sure I understand, you're looking for a representative of the principal entity for item C, and I'd look to the audience, and if there's a applicant principal representative, please come up to the mic and that may be addressed and introduce yourself, please.
Good morning. My name is Larry Sellers. I'm a partner in the Holland & Knight Law Firm. I am the counsel for Southport Financial Services and the entity that is the applicant for this request for approval. With me are several officials from Southport, Mike Molinari, Brian Hefner, as well as some others. So if you have some specific questions, we'd be happy to answer them.
Okay.
Attorney Sellers, one of my questions is, once you are through underwriting, who will be the, or which entity will be the property management company for this project?
The currently approved property management company, this has already been approved, I guess, through credit underwriting, is Cambridge Management Company.
Okay. And, all right. And if you don't mind, can I
Sure, go ahead.
Streamline, would that be the case for item D and E?
That's correct.
Okay. I have no further questions.
Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else? Any questions? Okay. Seeing none, I have a motion and a second for item C. Okay. Any, no more discussion? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any against?
Aye.
Okay. All right, now we'll go to motion to item D. Okay, any discussion? Motion on item D?
Motion to move item D.
Second.
A motion and a second. Discussion. Tasha, any item?
I don't have any further discussion.
Okay.
My question was answered. That's why I wanted
okay.
to streamline.
Thank you. Okay, if nothing else, we have a motion and a second. All in favor of item D?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Item E?
No,
oh,
you have one opposed.
One opposed.
Oh, one opposed, I'm
Thank
sorry.
The motion passes.
Okay. Item E?
Move item E.
Second.
Have motion and a second. Discussion. Seeing no discussion.
I'll just ask one question.
Sure.
Is there an issue with Cambridge?
Yes, there is, and I'm glad that you asked that. So,
probably should have asked that the first time.
So, and first and foremost, I want to say, you know, good morning to everyone, and thank you again for taking time to come down and further the initiative for affordable housing. So, I'm going to go ahead and read from my statement because that way I'll embody precisely what I'm concerned about. So as the low-income advocate of this board, I owe a duty to the constituents of this state and to this organization. We must all put aside personal relationships and friendships when we make decisions. I, particularly, am here to be a voice for those who are often underrepresented and are many times voiceless. Therefore, if I am appalled at the conditions of a property, it seems irresponsible to me to award bad behavior and vote for other projects by said developer. However, many want me to believe that my hands are tied because the projects are affiliated with other entities and different community projects. Nevertheless, I believe this board is here to serve as a check and balance to staff recommendations. We cannot serve as a rubber stamp. It is my job to ask the difficult questions and to ensure accountability in our developers that we support. As such, I am asking for a specific rule development in the future that addresses bad actors in property management and any other concerns that impacts tenants. If a property presents credible concerns for its tenants and others in the community, we must have a policy in place that allows the developer to correct those issues before we move forward on voting on new projects for that entity. I do not want to impose suspension as a point of primary recourse. That seems a bit drastic, but I do want to require resolution to said concerns. I do not want a Band-Aid. I want substantial evidence that the concern has been addressed and the issues are significantly resolved. The optics of pushing forward on new funding and projects for a developer who is currently mismanaging a community that was previously funded seems dismissive, and that doesn't sit well with me. The efforts that I have seen by some in regards to my concern about how any developer manages a property
that leads to safety and health issues for its tenants is disheartening and alarming. I've heard more excuses and deflection of responsibility than you can possibly imagine. My goal is to do right by those we serve, as well as Florida Housing Finance. If the same energy I've experienced over the past few days was put into the pervasive rodent and pest concerns, I likely would not have to make this statement. These are not trivial concerns. The concerns are real, and I would feel this way about any developer and any mismanaged property that poses health and safety violations for its residents. I realize that my position is not popular. Still, please know that I am always striving to do what is best for our constituents and this organization. Our true character is known when things are uncomfortable and unpopular. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Latasha. Okay, anyone else?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, sir.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Go ahead.
No. Ryan, first.
Latasha, is it with Southport or is it with Cambridge that you experience the concerns, or is it both?
It is with primarily Cambridge. The issue, though, is that there are some principles that overlap between the developer and the property manager.
The related entities, then?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you.
And if just follow up with that, is it systemic or is it isolated to one particular property?
It's isolated to only one or two properties that I'm aware of, one in particular. In a community in our city. However, I don't want to dismiss it to it being just a property. What I am concerned about is that if there's any real issues with any property, that we should have something in place that we're not pushing forward new projects. Because we do get questioned, you know? So we had a media person reach out to understand why we are continuing to push forward on projects. And I do understand that there's a conversation about this has already been approved and this and that. And the bottom line is, what are our guiding principles? And I'll just take us back to that on our organization, is to be mindful and accountable stewards of resources entrusted to us. How are we being mindful and accountable if we are pushing forward on new projects and we have nothing in place outside of, as we call it, nuclear war, to kind of say, okay, hold for a moment, get some things in order, and then we can move forward with the great work that you're doing.
On more isolated basis, so if it's an individual property that is being mismanaged by a company, and I'm not that familiar with Cambridge, but I mean, I don't know how large they are and how many projects they manage, but you know, obviously you can always have, you know, a bad apple, right, which, you know, should be dealt with. So are you saying that, you know, when this occurs, we should have something in place to be able to deal with that situation in that particular project? Or is this something that, you know, you're looking to blanket, you know, for, you know, all, you know, developers?
So I'm looking for it with all developers in terms of having a rule in place.
In terms of the oversight of their projects, so if they have a third-party manager managing their projects and it's being mismanaged,
mm-hmm.
that we have something in place to deal with that situation.
So that there's not a situation where it looks like we keep saying, okay, we'll give you more money or we'll support more projects, but we haven't, you know, handled what's going on over here, even though we clearly know it's going on.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Laura, can you address some of
Yes, if I may, Mario, Southport has 85 developments in our portfolio, and when we have any issues with any development in our portfolio, and we'll address particularly exigent health and safety issues, we'll contact code enforcement, other funders in the deal, limited partners. We require a plan for remediation of whatever the issue is. If it's not a plan that looks like it'll work, we will, you know, go have a dialogue back and forth on this particular property. We it hit the news because COVID, the IRS regulations suspended physical inspections. So we were in the property, and I'm getting lost on the time, either December 9th, 2019, I think it was, because COVID happened in 2020. So we were at the property December 2019. We didn't see any issue. We sample a percentage of units based on the regulations. And residents often talk to us if there are any issues. Some residents are afraid to talk to us because they don't want to put themselves in jeopardy. You always have the two. But when it hit the press May of this year, we started monthly inspections. Code enforcement has been out and levied, I think, 85,000 fines. I'm sure the principal would be better to answer this. We didn't see the improvement that we had hoped for in the inspections, so we asked for an updated plan. So it's not like we aren't doing anything to address it. We're out there. They do need time to get rid of it, but we're out there monthly, and we'll continue to monitor it until it is fixed. And this one had tax credits, too, so we filed reports with the IRS that could cause recapture of credits.
Well, Laura, do we have the finished? I know there was a recent inspection of which Board Member Green Cobb attended some of that inspection. Do we have that final inspection report?
I do not yet. I'm sure we can move that up, but it's not ready yet. The monitor typically has 30 days. They gave us a brief summary, and it was, you know, it still needs to be addressed.
Right. Thank you.
Sandra?
First, I want to thank Vice Chair Green Cobb for her comments. I wish they would have heard those comments before we started any of the voting. It definitely strikes a chord with me. I spent several years working for a nonprofit with families living in substandard living conditions. And you're right, for a board that works towards pursuing affordable housing, it needs to be safe and healthy utmost. My question for Marissa, because this is now on my radar. I heard Laura say that Southport has 85 properties. How many of those, or are they all managed by Cambridge? And then I'd be interested to note, again, how widespread this issue may or may not be and what we have in place. I know that Laura just spoke to that a little bit. But when something does come to our attention, and we do know that there is that relationship between the developer and the property management company, do we then put additional eyes on it? I don't know if the question is for Marissa or for Laura. Do we then put additional eyes on it and perhaps look to do some unannounced property assessments on some of the other properties? Or is it just random for anyone, and maybe it's this company and maybe it's not?
So I think you heard this during the retreat. Any development that has housing credits only, we go out once every 3 years until they hit the 15th year, and then we go out once every year. Any property with debt, we go out once every year. Due to COVID, physical inspections have been suspended. They're due to start again October 1st. We were fortunate that our first housing was able to find someone to go out during this time and visit for us. If not, we would have done it ourselves. But because we have reports, I mean, typically this one is a Section 8 property, and unfortunately HUD hadn't been doing their inspections either for, I think, 5 years, which is before COVID. But whenever something happens, and I have alerts set up on the portfolio so I can monitor, I mean, it's unfortunately be press, right? But monitor in between our reviews as well. As soon as anything happens, whether it's our review or something in the press, we jump into action. And if there are residents' complaints, which we get, we call them resident concerns, but we have 5 staff that handle those, and they do other work just other than that. And we get those resolved. I don't know if I've answered your question, but it's not like we are not addressing every situation that we see. And like I said, they have 85 other properties. And yes, there was noncompliance in some others, nothing to this level. I mean, this has been bad, but they've got, they changed their, actually they should speak to what they've done. But Florida Housing does follow up on all of the issues that we are aware of in our portfolio.
When did we first become aware of the issues at that specific property?
On this one, like I said, we were there December 2019, we did not see it. It hit the press in May.
May of this year or last year?
This year.
This year. Yeah. And like I said, we've been out since, actually, through the relationship with the governor's office. We've been, DBPR has been out quite often as well. So it's like a full court press from our point of view.
Hugh, do you want to be recognized?
Sorry.
Hugh?
No.
No.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes. Go ahead.
I want to be incognito.
But I'm familiar with what initiated it since it was in my area. My suggestion would be to ask the staff, as has been requested by the vice chair, to come back with a recommendation, make it an agenda item, and that gives them time. As imaginative as our staff is, I'm sure they'll come back with a fantastic recommendation or recommendations. It's going to be a challenge, though, because it's not easy for us to impose our will after the cow is out of the barn, and that's part of the problem. So I think we need to be very thoughtful about what we do in reaction to this going into the future. So that's my suggestion or request, Mr. Chairman.
Oh, Marissa.
And I just want to make sure I understand, and we understand the request that's being made. What I heard Board Member Green Cobb say was a request for some rule development in the future for bad actors related to property management as it relates to future funding. And so that's what we're talking about prospectively. And that the motion for these are still on the item. Well, two have been voted on, but the right one that's still remaining is still on the table to be considered. Is that correct?
We have a motion and a second. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mr. Chair, is Cambridge a third-party manager, or they're owned by the principals?
They have principals in common.
Okay. All right. I understand.
Mr. Chair. Sorry.
Yes.
I echo the setup for awkwardness for trying to talk.
Do you guys need flags down there?
Well, at least they make it all the way to the end. He's the one, like, in timeout over here.
I'm in timeout, and I'm about to drop off.
Maybe part of it, while we're developing the concept, even an awareness as we're approving new multifamily bonds with bonds or sale funding, whatever, that we are aware of open violations on other developer and related properties as we're going through, and it gets presented as such, you know, in the report.
Marissa? I'm sorry.
Laura, there is a compliance status and a past due status for the principals of each entity that is in the underwriting report. All of our underwriters include that in the underwriting reports.
Yes.
Once it goes to underwriting, after we've approved it.
No, prior to approval. And one of our underwriters, I think it would be helpful for y'all to hear for the underwriting firm assigned to these transactions.
Yeah.
Ben?
My name is Ben Johnson. I'm the group, and we are the underwriter of record on all three of those transactions. But just from a global perspective, every one of our recommendations that prior to closing, any non-compliance issues, any past due issues for that transaction and or related party transactions have to be cleared. That's in your recommendation as you speak, okay, as approved by the board. So that caveat is already there. And so we can get to closing and there can be a determination that this has not been handled accordingly and we wouldn't close. So that's a condition of every report. We also take the management company selection process very, very seriously as well. After our underwriting recommendation was approved, that is true. But we're monitoring them as well. And our indication is that it is a relatively isolated incident. There are proactive actions taking place to correct them as we speak. But we do take this very seriously as well.
So to further that thought, sorry, Mr. Chairman,
yes.
And I appreciate the underwriting reports. They're lengthy, but I appreciate the level of detail for them. If it's not too cumbersome in the agenda portion, our action portion, to note in one of those paragraphs how many developments that party principal has currently on the books with us, and how many, if any, are in violation.
And I can tell you, if this had come to our, we had been notified of this, were aware of this before our underwriting report, we would have listed it. we would have noted it. So all eyes open, and then that and our recommendation obviously would mean conditioned upon resolution of that issue. So we do put that information in. The reason it wasn't in this one, it came to light after our recommendation was made and approved.
So, Mr. Chair.
Just hold it.
I'm sorry.
Natasha.
Thank you, Chair. Director Benson, I actually requested something similar because an item was in our consent agenda in June that went forward, having already had notice in May. And so that was a concern for me that we were not notified as a board and made aware of what was, you know, a serious concern. It also is concerning for me that underwriting did approve or other entities did approve when having visited the property. There are a few different residents that have issues that go beyond 3 to 5 years. So those were concerns for me because I'm trying to understand the inspection process and how that works out and how selection is made on units. But there were not just issues that just popped up within the last year. So I just wanna go on record for that.
Mario.
So then my question is that, I guess for Seltzer is, so given the current situation, and we have, I guess, three projects here. So given the current situation, and if the current situation is not resolved, are you saying that the decision would be not to close, even though if we move forward with the vote of yay on this, are you saying that, you know, if this issue still exists, then these deals would not close?
Well, I think there would have to be a determination if we're going to close or not. And and what that decision factor is, I guess, could come across a couple things. We think they are being proactive, and they are addressing the problem. And I think if we thought the answer to that was no, we would say no.
So it seems like there is a check in place. Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
Okay. Hugh. How does this apply to items C, D, or E?
Well, C and D have already been voted on. E is pending. We have a motion and a second.
Yes.
We've had a little bit of discussion. And so the motion is still pending for a vote.
Right. But, I mean, the management situation, how does that apply to item E?
It doesn't, in the absence of evidence that this particular development has a problem.
Okay.
There is a concern expressed about it being the same management company. If that affects your vote, it affects your vote. But, you know, staff recommendation is still to grant because we believe they meet the criteria for this request as those criteria are defined.
Great. Okay, I have a motion and a second on item E. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Motion passes.
Motion passes.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Can I get an acknowledgement that that will be an agenda item in the next meeting?
I tell you what, Board Member Gulliford, what we will do is we will circle, I will work with Laura Cox and with Marissa Button and with Hugh, and we'll come back to the board with at the Panama City board meeting here in 6 weeks or so with, with a discussion item about how to move forward with any proposed rule. I know there's a timeline for rulemaking, which Marissa may be able to address here because that's a yearly function of the board.
Right.
So I don't know if you and Hugh can talk about that, but...
Yes, and I think what's an important component when we're talking about these big issues is public input as well and stakeholder input.
Sure.
So we wouldn't want to bring a recommendation to y'all without probably publicly workshopping
and
some component of that as well.
And I understand, listen, it may be after discussion that there's a decision made not to advance a rule. So, and I understand the difficulty of it because some of it is after the cow's out of the barn, how do you go back and take some kind of punitive action or any action to remedy? And so I'm understanding of it. But I think it certainly needs a further discussion and put it to bed.
We will absolutely create a plan.
Okay. Yep. Okay. And we'll be back with you will be at least an item to talk through at the Panama City meeting.
Okay, moving on. Hugh Brown, present yes, legal sir. Item A.
So my legal item A is the matter of Kelsey Cove. It is a petition for waiver, case number 2021-054-VW. Petitioner in this case successfully applied for an award of housing credits to assist in the construction of a 108-unit family development just across the bay here in Hillsborough County. Petitioner asked for a waiver of Rule 6748.0075(3)(a), which defines the total development cost and limits the real property acquisition cost in that to the appraised value as determined during credit underwriting. Specifically, the petitioner is asking here that the TDC, the total development cost, include the actual purchase price instead of the appraised value. The difference between those values is the actual purchase price was $3.24 million. The appraised value was $2.16 million, as shown in your documents. The petitioner has pointed out that and stated that the price on this property was inflated as a result of it being a specific goal in RFA 2020-202 to fund a single geographic area of opportunity development in Hillsborough County, just one. Petitioner says that this goal, as a result, limited the availability of the sites, drove up the price, and made it so they had to pay quite a bit more for the property that met the criteria in the RFA for the one single goal that we had in that county. Petitioner also points out that there are multiple ways to do that, to get to the ultimate allocation. The ultimate allocation at the end of the housing credit process is not necessarily what it is at the beginning. And during that time, there are ways to calculate it in such a way that the corporation would not really be disadvantaged by granting this request, which we began to think about. The Internal Revenue Code pertaining to housing credit allocations requires that the corporation provide no more housing credits than is deemed necessary to ensure the project's financial feasibility throughout the 15-year IRS compliance period. It also requires us to consider the reasonableness of the costs. We have a rule that implements this requirement by more or less defining reasonable as the lesser of the qualified basis calculation, the gap calculation, or the housing credit award considered in the application. So it would be considered the lesser of those three. Now, the petitioner is correct that if the actual purchase price is considered in the TDC instead of the appraised cost, the lesser appraised cost, the gap calculation will be higher than the qualified basis calculation or the application housing credit award, so one of those would be used in the calculation. This would mean that as a result, they would probably get fewer credits in the back end. Conversely, if the appraised value is used, the gap calculation will be the lowest, which results in the development getting fewer, in this case, the development would get fewer credits and possibly even return some back to the calculation. So as much as this may provide some safeguard to the corporation, there are still is some risk of the development getting more housing credits than necessary to cover the increased price. So we have to be mindful of protecting our ability to control this process and prevent excess allocations. So this is a situation where granting this waiver could impact other participants in the housing credit program and could otherwise have a detrimental effect. However, as we've had extensive discussions with the petitioner and with our financial genius staff, and we now agree that circumstances demonstrate that they are, as the statute requires, going to experience a substantial hardship if the rule were not waived. And we agree that granting the waiver, albeit with the safeguards that we want to put in, does serve the purpose of the statute. So to make this work while also placing some safeguards for the corporation, we would recommend granting this waiver, but with three conditions. And because this involves very specific financial language, I'm just going to read it.
Yeah, and Hugh, can you clarify that what the board members have in front of them is the correct, or is it an email?
The last email that you got involving this item changed the recommendation from deny to grant with conditions. So you should have a write-up that provides for grant with conditions.
Yeah. So on the back of page 4, at the bottom, the stack recommendation, the board grant petitioner's request for waiver. That's what we're going off, and it should all be at your station, and they can work off of this.
Exactly.
Okay,
and just above that, these three conditions are listed. One, that the cost of acquiring real property in any of the buildings, deposits, options, contracts to purchase properties that exceed the appraised value will be included as a line item development cost and included in the TDC per unit calculation, and the inclusive total cost amount is subject to the applicable TDC cost per unit limitation process. And if you don't understand that, we have people here to explain that, because that'd be good. Number two, the development remains a 9% competitive housing credit award without any other corporation allocated resources associated with the housing credit development. And three, that the applicant and developer must provide verified affidavits that there is no affiliation between any of the principals or affiliates of the principals of the applicant and developer and seller, or any affiliate of the seller of the subject property, as well as no agreements other than the purchase contract between the applicant and developer and the seller, or any affiliate of the seller of the subject property.
Okay, I need a motion to staff recommendation.
So moved.
I need a second.
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 Okay, I have a motion, a second. Discussion.
Yes, Chair.
Mario.
Yep. Okay, so I just have a few things and to really describe why I'm in support of this. So the first thing is, let me caveat that I have not read the appraisal, so I'm really not sure, what its contents say. But I can say that in 30 years of reviewing appraisals in my job, that appraisals are data driven, a lot of historical data, but at the same time, they have subjectivity to them, right? So it's up to the appraiser to kind of interpret all this and then, determine a value. Sometimes it might be wrong, and I've seen it. So, just given that. But, more importantly, in this case, it seems that, I guess, there were two applications, right? This was the one that qualified and met all the requirements. Our job is to get affordable housing built in much needed areas. So here are a few things that I researched with regard to this area. All right, the population of this area has grown 15% in the last year. That's huge, right? The occupancy of multifamily in this area is 96%. That means there's really not a lot of supply. Now couple that with the increased population, and you can kind of figure out that, there's a housing situation here. And, maybe this growth in population is a blip, in terms of, how high it is at 15%, is that pretty high, right? But we've seen over the last decade immigration into Florida. It used to be, 1,000 people a day. Now it's like 2,000 people a day. So I believe that this housing is needed in this area, and this is why I'm in support of it.
Yes.
Echo the comments of Board Member Sella, thank you. And also on that, yes, our job is to deploy affordable housing for people and also do the most number of units we can deploy with the same amount of money. I also am in favor of this revised. I thank staff for all their hard work. I know in the last couple weeks of coming together with terms that are acceptable. And the reason that I'm going to support it is because I understand that it's not $1 million delta that is coming out that could do something different. This is an equation calculation, which is why I'm in support of this with the parameters staff has created.
Okay, Sandra.
Yeah, agreed. I want to acknowledge staff for digging deep to really get to, for me it's always about the spirit and the intent of our rules, and so I'm glad that the developer and staff were able to come to terms to turn this deny into an approve, and look forward to approving it. Thank you.
Okay. Yes.
Yeah, I agree. I think staff did a good job here of making the best out of this situation, and I always want to support staff where I can. I would just ask that going forward, the applicant did acknowledge that the RFA process drove up the cost, and I think any time that happens, that's bad for everybody, other than the land seller, I guess, but in terms of our mission to deliver as many units at the best possible price. So if staff could just explore what it was specific about this RFA that may have actually done that, and try to avoid that in the future as best we can. And I know it's a complicated task, but I just think it's something we should always keep an eye on so that we're not making our job and the developer's job and everyone's job more difficult, driving up land prices.
Marissa,
Mr. Chairman, can I ask Marissa to clarify that? Because that's different than my understanding.
Yep. Go ahead, Marissa.
Thanks. I'm trying to figure out where to mesh those two. I think the what's really important here is this rule serves a very important purpose, that there is not a windfall to land sellers through our affordable housing programs. So that is key to one of those conditions placed on the approval process, that certainly we don't want that to happen in any type of potentially affiliated situation, which is not what we have here, to all of our knowledge. But still going forward, to your point, Dev, we do not want to create this conditional approval here to create an incentive for land sellers to be able to enrich unjustly off of the system that we have. And we feel like we've done a very good job overall of not pinpointing specific sites in the state that drive up bidding wars. Inherently, when we want to have a threshold of where we want to see developments, it is always that balance. We've evolved, before my time with Florida Housing, many other people here longer, scoring criteria that would have said this is the site and this is the place. We've evolved from that now. But we have a case-specific situation here, right? But I just want to ensure that we are very mindful of this, and we are very mindful of the importance of this rule not negatively impacting that going forward, and in our RFA process and how it works together. Right. Thank you.
Yes,
Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And we keep talking about staff, but I'm going to mention her by name. Marissa, you've done a yeoman's job on this, and I know that you've communicated to the entire board. You walked us through this whole process, and you said you did a good job. You did an amazing job. So thank you so much.
Any other board members? I just want to talk after when y'all are all done.
Phil.
I guess I need to chime in. I understand the importance of maintaining the integrity of rules, but circumstances drive exceptions, and I think this is the classic example of that, and that's why we sit up here and rules and do have the ability to make exceptions, and I think this is a classical example of that. I understand that we really, really need to be careful on that issue.
Thank you.
And I too applaud you, but I already applaud you, so that's the okay. Things you do, so. You do a great job.
Trey.
Unless there's any other
questions. I just have one other question.
Go ahead.
I'll go last.
And this is really just regarding the rule itself. In terms of, situations like this popping up in the future, I mean, if there's a challenge from the developer side or the applicant, is there an ability right now to, go and get another appraisal, or and where I'm going with this, perhaps if there is a challenge that there's maybe a 3 appraisal rule where there might be an average, of the 3, if the developer's willing to pay for, those appraisals. It's just like a thought that I had, and I see that a lot of times in mediation. So anyway, I just thought I'd throw that out.
Thank you. And if I just may have the opportunity to respond to that, similar to the topic we previously discussed, we go into rural development in January, and we're open to looking at this. I think if you were to poll folks in the audience, everybody would have a different opinion or position or challenge they've experienced with the process, which is in some ways why this was so very important. We have never waived this rule before, and to be very considerate about it and also consider retroactively, we don't, you know, in the box that we created and trying to be mindful about the policy of why this would make sense to conditionally approve, that it would not negatively impact others who had come through the process and had the calculation impact them. But prospectively, we have to also understand that this is, you know, everything that the board does make certain types of precedent, and we'll be mindful of that. But I think always, you know, looking at how we analyze this process as it comes up in rule development is something that we can absolutely look at.
Okay. Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So I get to heap praise on Marissa and her staff as well. I will tell you the key ingredient for me with pushing this ahead and supporting it is the total development cost limits, which the applicant has agreed to come in at or below. So I feel like those cost controls are covered. But that's really the linchpin for me, you know, and you know, as Marissa alluded to, actually said, is that this rule has never been waived before. I will tell you that, you know, I'm always going to have some concerns about what will happen in the future, but support this and ask that you do as well. Thank you.
Okay. We have a motion and a second. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Seeing none, we'll go ahead and move on. Marissa.
All right. This is our multifamily programs item. So this is the fruition of your robust discussion at the retreat last board meeting or prior to last board meeting in July. We are coming to you with a recommendation in your materials to reserve corporation funds for development viability loan program. And I'm not going to read this whole item to you, just going to hit the high notes here. We're asking for a reservation of $20 million to go ahead and workshop and issue an RFA for developments that are currently in the development pipeline with a corporation award that have not yet had a notice of commencement of construction or rehab at this point, and who need essentially viability resources to get over the finish line. Some of the guiding principles for this was very similar. It will look very similar to the viability loan program that we issued back in 2017, which had came up in conversation previously as well. So y'all know we have done something similar in the past. So I'm just going to focus on the differences to what we're recommending here. And so you have that in your materials and subpart on page 2 of the item in subpart F. There's some guiding requirements and criteria that we thought would be reasonable. And remember, the goal of this is to get those who need the dollars over the finish line, ensuring that they have exhausted all possible options before coming to Florida Housing for the resources. And to also acknowledge that there have been developments that have been able to achieve that threshold and may have taken you know, cuts in fee or done some value engineering to get themselves across the finish line and balancing all of those things. So we would be and we think it's important not to just say we're going to go do this and then workshop it, but to really have the board's understanding of what we're talking about when we go out and workshop that RFA before we issue it. So we would seek a 40% minimum deferred developer fee as a condition for applying for funding. We would need updates that they still have their commitments from equity providers on their developments. We will establish a per development, like total limit in dollar amount and a per unit limit as we did previously. We'll work through those numbers. We will consider limiting the amount of awards a particular development group can get. We don't want to have this limited pool. And so we will probably implement some type of priority one, priority two designation like we do in the 9% geographic RFAs. We are going to employ a conservative approach to the allocation of the funds, size everything in underwriting, and as well look at it at cost certification, and make sure that those developments that are bringing additional funds to the table that they did not have at their original application, that we see those there, those essentially get leveraged higher, rewarding them for going out and locking in the funding, and that when they commit to us with that application that they've got that funding, they have it at the end of the day as well, so that doesn't fall off and then we're still filling the gap. They will be required and be on a time frame to successfully complete underwriting within their original due dates or giving them a six-month gap if they're in such a circumstance in the pipeline that that may have expired already, and they're on extension time anyway. And the same idea with closing as well, that we'll have a tight closing time period. And so I talked about the tiebreakers, looking at the new non-corporation funding commitments, demonstrating that they've been added since the original app pro forma, and then looking at the amount of units we get per viability loan funding. So that's really important too, that you're gonna rank higher if we're getting more units out of what viability funding we're putting into the development as well. And the big one that has that we've been working through, number 10 on that, is that we would suggest a consequence that the successful applicants in the viability loan program are limited in the prospective funding cycle to submitting priority two applications exclusively in the three 9% housing credit RFAs. That provides them with the ability to, if they've got a development in the pipeline, they can still apply for sale, they can still apply for non-competitive resources, they can still apply in all of the specialized demographic RFAs and our preservation RFA. So we're not shutting down, you're not searching shutting down lines of business. We are suggesting those hyper-competitive awards that they have a lower priority than the competitors who have been able to get across the finish line. And we understand how meaningful that is, but we think it hopefully does a job of meeting in the middle with what felt like after the retreat last month, the board's collective desire that there does need to be a consequence, yet we don't want to lose good awards that may be in the pipeline anyway. Or I shouldn't say pipeline yet, but you know, they're the folks are working towards and want to be able to apply for funding. So those are the general guiding criteria and requirements. Some have asked, why does 20 million get at everything? And the answer is, we don't know that for sure yet. We went through the process of the development pro forma survey. We had folks sort of all over the board. They weren't held to it. We were trying to get an idea of what's going on. So what we know is it's probably not to the extreme that it was at that point in time in late May, early June, also because prices are going down. There's a little bit of equilibrium happening. So folks are able to make different business decisions probably now perhaps than they were 3 months ago, 4 months ago, but also some are still in their circumstances living with it. So that we thought that the $20 million was, you know, working with Angie, that was a reasonable number out of what that line item is for demonstration and other initiatives that you have. That was the number we actually used originally in the viability loan program that we did back in 2017, 2018 as well. So what we felt like is we if we're not sure that it's going to get at everything and it will potentially be competitive, you know, ideally we would have enough to size everything perfectly, but if it's going to be competitive, we need to have some of those tiebreakers in place to make sure we're getting at those that give us the most for what we're putting out there. So with that, I ask for the approval of the reservation of $20 million in corporation funding to use for the competitive gap funding loan program and authorize staff to develop, workshop, and issue a development viability loan funding RFA. And staff behind the scenes is working really hard at this, so we will be able to workshop by the end of the month, ideally, get this out and get awards to you if everything goes smoothly by the December board meeting. So that's what's also happening in the background as well. So we're
going to need a motion to staff recommendation.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. A discussion. I've got a question. If you're talking about additional debt to make up for any of that, is there any adjustment to debt coverage ratios? Or, I mean, I always worry when somebody is looking to get maybe additional loans or additional debt to cover shortfalls. So I'm just curious.
Well, we're still going to require all of the minimum coverage. The coverage ratios that are required by rule will still be required. And so we're going to size and look at everything as it comes to us. And we didn't have issues with that in the last go around either.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, this is also, yep, as it's structured right now, is 0% loan. So it's really not going to add to it.
Wouldn't make a difference.
But I do have a few things, if I may.
Okay.
Okay, so look, first off, and it's not mentioned in here, but I think we all know that to a large extent, costs have been driven up by the pandemic, right? And in addition to also increased demand, again, by the influx of folks migrating to Florida. So this is not isolated to just affordable housing. This is across the board, and I'm seeing it everywhere. My thoughts on this, and I will say that I would like to propose an amendment to this to strike number 10, and that's basically the punitive clause to make developers, you know, wait around, et cetera. So with regard to that, and look, the way I see this and how I've seen it in my experience is that if a developer has cost overruns and, you know, a bank, you know, says, you know, look, you got to come up with, you know, other sources other than, you know, the bank's funds because, you know, it doesn't meet our debt service coverage or loan to value, et cetera. So if that developer is not willing or can't put in additional equity into those projects, they go to lenders of last resort, right? Which is higher interest rate right. type loans, subordinate. We're proposing here a 0% interest on loans. So why not have it as more of a lender of last resort? Because that's what we want. That's what Marissa just said. And impose an interest rate on this that, one, you know, the corporation, you know, gets paid for, you know, putting out valuable resources, right? But at the same time, it helps, you know, these developers who need to do it, right? The other criteria, you know, they all have to meet, but, you know, I just don't think it's fair given the environment that we're in to penalize, you know, developers, which could potentially deter projects, you know, from being built. So that's my recommendation is to amend this without number 10.
So the motion to amend?
Yeah, would you clarify your amendment, be more specific? You're suggesting an interest
rate. My motion is to, you know, to approve
right.
Staff recommendation without number 10.
Okay, so between Hugh and I, we'll be parliamentarians here, I guess, for a moment. Mm-hmm. I think what you would propose is an amendment to the motion to strike number 10.
Number 10.
Is that correct?
Correct.
And is that all that you would amend?
That's all I have.
Okay. And so, Hugh, what's the next?
Also with the suggestion, I mean, yeah. I don't know how we would deal with the interest rate instead of making it a 0% loan, you know, impose some sort of interest rate on the loan.
That's why I wanted clarification, and I think we need to maybe even be a little more specific in that amendment. How is that rate set?
Well, I mean,
is it a below market rate that you established to as part of that?
Well, it's already below market, right, at 0%. So, I mean, you know, I think that would probably need to be researched a little bit, but in my experience, these types of loans are priced in the 5 to 8% range, right? Some even 10 to 12. You know, I'm not, because we're all trying to, you know, move towards a goal of getting housing built. I'm not saying to have such a punitive rate as like 10 or 12%, but maybe like a 5% rate.
Right. I like your motion. Yeah. I just wonder if we need to be more specific as far as a rate, or if we make it as a recommendation to come back from staff as a staff. I don't have any problem with a below market rate, a considerably
right.
below market rate. I think your idea is great because I've been wrestling with the heart and the head. The heart says help these people. The head says why are you helping them when other people are performing without any help, and the private sector is out there getting hammered, so why are you jumping in? And this really addresses a lot of that part of the concern.
Thank you.
So I think Kevin needs to...
Kevin?
Yeah, I'll comment on that. I'm Kevin Tatro, Managing Director of Development Finance for Florida Housing. I just want to go into the give and take of the recommendation and your suggestion. So I know everyone's been impacted this equally across the whole board here, even outside of our industries. But yet, some of our developers and properties have been able to move ahead anyway by the developers taking their own hit, you know, giving up monies, doing their own monies into the deals, and seeing it through. And so the sit-out recommendation of number 10 was to indicate that those who are not willing to do that, there's other means to have them recognize that there is a cost to this process. That was that recommendation. But with that said, I want to move on to the interest rate comment. So the give and take of adding interest rate to a like a government subsidized loan, there's only so much cash flow to go around. And so when we or any government imposes an interest rate on their subsidy funds, even though it's cash flow dependent on the payment, it's underwritten as if it is being paid. And so as you add cash requirements to the subsidized loan, the cash available then on the first mortgage is reduced. And so what's going to happen is you're going to have reduction in the first mortgage because we're imposing an interest rate on the subordinate debt. Now, it's, you'll get more money on the subordinate debt than the loss of the first mortgage, but it adds higher subsidy requirements as you cut back on the first mortgage. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All right. So, just one question.
Sorry. Go ahead.
Ladies first.
I was just going to add to your point and to Bill's point. I think it would be it might not be the most prudent for us to vote on a specific. If you were inclined to go that route, to vote on a specific interest rate today. But if you wanted to see something above 0%, we could include that in the workshopping that would happen as we build the RFA and get, you know, stakeholder consensus about what that additional thing would really mean to the transactions is the one to add.
Okay, Sandra, then.
So first of all, kudos. You know, to me, the big difference between the 2017 viability program, which was before my time, and this one is ARPA, ARPA, ARPA from both of the electeds that we heard today. They are setting aside ARPA dollars. You know, I think it's incumbent upon any developer to first go to their local government. They're obviously going to know much more down in the weeds about the projects in comparison. I don't want us to suffer from analysis paralysis, but what is one why does one project need help in one specific area and the three others don't? So I'm glad that there's language in there that sort of will require that step to be taken. For clarification purposes, are we approving the viability loan program and its language today, or are we just preliminary approving it? It's going to go to workshop, and then it'll come back to us for final approval.
So what our request is that you would approve the workshopping and issuing with these guiding principles in place. And this is sort of exactly why we wanted to get some threshold understanding if the board's objective is, if they find the number 10 acceptable, that's going to be included. If they don't, we won't include it. These were sort of the big picture things.
So that's specifically why I'm asking. Yep. So for the purpose of, so if we technically we could leave in place 10 today, it could be workshopped. We know that there's going to be a lot of pushback, and then we could remove 10 at the next meeting if we wanted to.
No,
or no?
Because we're going to move so quickly. We want to get it workshopped
and issued.
Okay, I just wanted that
clarification.
That's why these were sort of the big ones. Usually we don't, you know, we don't come asking for each term of the RFA, but we know this has been, you know, it's such a big issue. If it's removed at your, you know, however, if the board takes the amendment and votes to remove it, it will not be there. If you do not take the amendment and vote, we will include it.
Okay. Who wants to go first?
I'm going to ask that Director Benson goes first because he's been asking for a moment, but you can't see him.
Thank you very much.
So, need to be taller.
Questions on 10. It specifically references applicant versus those that have been granted. So not just applied, but granted. So question and concern on that. And then the other is this a permanent loan that becomes a part of the project loan, or is it a short-term capital And the reason I'm asking, if it's something that was short-term, where they could use a portion of their profits to get to eliminate any debt, would we consider, if they do not have any outstanding debt as a part of this loan program, that they could go for the other applications? Does that make sense?
I think so. I'll address the first part. The intent was that the principals of successful applicants, so they would have to get to your
So those that have been granted.
Those
okay.
that have been, right, those that have been awarded. I think this is intended to be permanent source and not coming in until after a final cost certification, so we ensure that they actually need it. I think the difficulty of using these funds and drawing on them in the short term is that, and you know, there's, especially in housing credit developments, that would create a whole other level of going to having to do inspections that are not done relative to the draw. I mean, it just really creates a different issue.
And I also have to, again, I know we applaud our staff, but it's only because we're so thrilled at the job you do of turning this from a workshop at the last meeting into something where we can vote today and immediately deploy capital that is desperately needed to fund these. So thank you guys again. That's incredible to turn it that fast.
Chair?
Yes.
Yeah. I just want to make a couple comments. You know, as a developer, I just got a cost increase of 7% on a job in the last 4 months. So while lumber, certain things are going down, certain things are also still going up. So I am sensitive to this topic. And I also struggled with 10 because I didn't think it was, because of that, I didn't think it was fair to penalize someone for a macro issue. That being said, in our workshop, I think we really weren't looking to penalize someone, but rather create a deterrent so that they looked at other options. And so I, when I started to think of it in that mind, remember that conversation, I got more comfortable. And then I put myself in a developer's shoes in this scenario. And there's probably, just to play a little devil's advocate, there's probably some developers that, because of the cash flow issues with some of the alternative options, would rather have a 0% loan because it's their only option and is okay with taking a year off on the competitive in order to have an option to keep an existing application going forward. So I don't think it's I don't know if there's a perfect solution, and it could be an either or where they take an interest rate or zero and sit out, which might be kind of a hybrid scenario. But you know, I think you guys did a great job in listening to us and thinking about it. I agree with you that we want to build as many units as we can. We don't want to discourage people from participating that are going through this because of a macro issue. So I'd be in support of either or. Otherwise, you know, I am in support of 10, but for that reason.
Okay. Yes.
To that end, I'd like to ask the proposer of the amendment to reclarify his amendment. He's heard some.
We're gonna need to have the amendment clarified for all the board members.
Exactly,
but
because
we've
heard the suggestion. We've heard the suggestion of a hybrid here, maybe even that's a possible consideration. So, if Mario would be kind enough to do that, remember where you're sitting, Mario. You may make fun of me at this end, but you're on that end, big boy.
Yeah. I do have one question before we go on to that, and this is with regard to those developers that are making this work. So here's my question. Because number 7 states that funding will be available to all developments in the pipeline that have not yet commenced construction or closed on funding. So to that extent, are developers making this work? And the reason why I ask this question is because, contractors are not holding their contracts for a long period of time. So, you know, this takes some time to get closed. So, you know, what your costs are at one point can definitely change by the time you close, right? So I'd like to hear a little bit on your experience of developers, you know, making it work prior to closing. Because, like, if they're in construction and they have, you know, they've already secured a number of contracts already, so that the actual increases to the job are a lot less than someone who's just starting their job and, you know, experiencing all this inflated costs.
Excuse me, may I?
Yes.
So it's a little bit across the board, and I'll speak even beyond those who have been able to make it work. Where we've seen issues, so the life cycle is we require, once developments are invited into credit underwriting, to get their guaranteed max price GC contract before underwriting occurs. And so that's a gap of time because they're working, they've got their 12 months to get through underwriting, they're working with it, and some things depend on whether they have a captive GC they're working with, or they're trying to, you know, they're smaller, they're out there, they're trying to lock in a GC. And so we have seen, I mean, it's sort of all over the place on where folks land at what point in time. And I think there's folks in the audience that would say, because I was here at this point in time, at this month, it worked, and then I had a deal where it was not the same circumstance. Notwithstanding that, there's then a time period once you've gotten you've gotten your underwriting approval, so you've got your GC Max contract, you have, you know, 4 more weeks till the board meeting approves the underwriting report, and you get your firm loan commitment, and then you're going to close in 6 weeks, and a GC is coming back to you and saying, I can't do it for what, you know, I said I could. And those are, that's a difficult thing that we continue to have an open dialogue with CAF about and try to work through how our rules, that what we want to see, impact some of this. And so for some, that's why you're seeing extension requests in some ways, because they're hoping that things may level out. Some have been able to push forward. And so in the other component, we haven't talked about this with viability, is also time. You know, we've heard some folks that are saying, I'm not gonna take that loan. What I know is if I get a little more time to get things worked out. And so you're gonna continue to see some of that. And I think it's a balance for folks' business decisions, where they're at, the resources they have, and what their, you know, relationships are. So, but we have seen, even on that, and that's why we couldn't say, if you haven't, we're not limiting it to the developments that have not completed underwriting yet, because some are in the gap, but some have certainly closed. And we have some on the list that did the pro formas that said, I don't know if I'm gonna have an issue or not, which have since, you know, they've been able to get their underwriting approvals and they're marching forward towards closing. So. There's not a lot of trend in there.
Okay. Anybody else?
So we just need the amendment.
We need a motion from Mario stated, because the current motion is to accept staff recommendation without changes.
Yeah, I was going to say, don't we have a motion already on the floor?
We need to figure out what it was.
Well, the motion on the floor was to accept staff's recommendation, because
yes.
I made the motion.
Right. But
then I did a motion.
Yeah, there was an amendment to the. Yeah.
But there was no motion on the amendment. So we're not in discussion on the amendment.
Right,
at the moment.
That's what I'm saying.
You already had the discussion on the amendment, I think.
Yeah.
Mario has made a motion. That motion has to be seconded and then voted upon.
You mean the amendment?
Amendment.
I think I seconded his amendment.
Right,
so
you definitely have now for sure.
So we're voting on the amendment first, and then.
There is a majority vote on whether or not to accept Mario's amendment.
Right.
Can we restate the amendment?
Then we don't have to vote again. So we're only going to vote a second time.
You will have to vote again, yes.
Yes. As amended.
Yes.
Yeah. Could you restate your amendment?
Yeah, my amendment was to, well, it's really two things, right? So it was to recommend staff with the exception of number 10. And impose an interest rate on the loan instead of having a 0% loan. That was my motion.
Okay. And we have a second for that motion?
No, I have a question.
Let's please get a second and have a motion, and we can have discussion. I will second the amendment.
Okay, now we can have discussion.
I have a question. When there's typically, and I've been in a few of these type of rooms in other organizations, typically when there's already a motion on the floor, that motion should have been voted on before an amendment can be done.
Then you've passed the motion without considering the amendment.
That's right.
Because we've already heard the conversation for the amendment.
We did have the discussion, which we should be having now already. We have a motion to amend, we have a second. We can have further discussion, but we have to have an up or down vote on whether to accept the amendment.
Correct.
The amended motion.
No.
The amendment.
Strike 10.
We have to have a vote on whether or not to accept Mr. Ficella's amendment to the original motion. Then you can vote on that afterward.
We are in discussion on that amendment now, correct?
We are in discussion on the amendment, which we have already had.
Okay. All right. All in favor?
No, we're in discussion.
Oh, you're still in discussion? Okay. Go ahead.
I am going to vote against the amendment because I would like to see a new amendment with Dev's recommendation in place instead.
So then they can.
Okay.
Well.
All right.
Further discussion?
But you still got to vote on mine, right?
Mr. Chairman, yeah.
Yes.
One quick, you know, we have a very nebulous reference to an interest, and I think that's what concerns me. I tend to agree with him. That's sort of what concerns me, unless staff would, we said something to the effect that staff would make a recommendation or would take a certain stance on it. And Marissa, if you've got any ideas on that, I'd like to hear them.
I would suggest the way that the proposed motion or the proposed amendment to the motion has been stated is acceptable because it's asking for, I want to make sure I got it, an interest rate above 0%. That allows us to workshop it, figure out whether it's one market, where we fall in between, but that gives us enough flexibility
right.
the way
so,
that was stated.
So he did say above, in his amendment, he did say above 0%, right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, good. I'm good with it, even though I'm going to vote against my patriot here.
Okay, Latasha.
My question to staff is whether it is more feasible to do the status change, do the priority two, or to have the interest rate?
I don't.
Because hearing from, and Lord, I'm forgetting his first name, Kevin, thank you. Hearing from him, there was some concern about proposing an interest rate.
Interest rate does put a financial stress with the principals and the development itself, which might be good enough in lieu of the other one. It's one or the other.
So then can I have a follow-up, Chair, please?
Yeah.
May I have a follow-up? Okay. So Board Member Matswani, I think I said it right. Matwani, thank you. His suggestion was to do either or. So do either they accept the priority two or the interest rate. Would you deem those as equitable options?
I don't deem them as equitable options because part of the impetus for addressing the limitation on those three RFAs was to acknowledge the fact that there are folks that have been able to get across the finish line and would not be competing with groups that needed to come back for more source. And that was the balance we were trying to achieve with the stakeholder feedback we were getting. So I don't think if they're not the same, but with the idea that for that purpose, they might not be the same, but for the purpose, as mentioned before, of being a deterrent to come in for the resources, I think they are both meaningful deterrents.
Okay, we need to vote on the stated amendment.
Yes, we do.
Okay.
Any other comments?
Any other comments before we vote? Okay. All right. All in favor of the amendment?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
Aye.
We're going to need a count.
You have to roll call it, Mr. Chairman.
Bill Gulliford?
Yes.
Ryan Benson?
No.
Latasha Green Cobb?
No.
Ron Lieberman?
No.
Sandra Einhorn?
No.
Dev Matwani?
No.
Holly Rashine?
Yes.
Adam Calloway? Mario Ficella.
Yes.
Okay, it's 5-4.
That's a 5-4, no. The motion fails. So we're back to the original motion to accept
we're
staff recommendation.
We're back to the original motion unless somebody
wants to do another motion to amend.
So is Director Matwani going to
Sure, I was going to let Mario offer it if he wanted to. Okay, so I'll offer an amendment to to give staff the option of either offering number 10 or in lieu of that deterrent, offer an interest rate above 0%.
Mr. Chair, can I make a friendly amendment?
No, I second that motion.
We need to get a second first.
I second that motion.
Thank you.
My understanding is if I make a friendly amendment and I was actually the original person to move, then we can vote on.
Okay.
You might need the book of rules or Robert's rules of order here.
Yeah, I got them right here.
So my comment was I was the original person to make the motion. So if I make a friendly motion to include his motion, then we don't need to go and vote on his separate. We can come back to mine,
Mr. Chairman, I think that's a substantive change to the first motion. I think you'd either have to do it by substitute or vote on the amendment that's been advanced, one or the other. Am I not right, Mr. Brown?
This would be cleaner to vote on the amendment that is advanced. Okay. And if somebody wants to then make another amendment, we can do it all day.
All right. Okay. You're right. Yep.
All right. Do we have a second?
I second.
We did.
Yeah.
Okay, we have a second. All right. Discussion.
I have something. So, so just for clarification, you're giving it staff option. Should it not be developer option of whether they want to sit out or incur an interest rate? Because you stated staff, so I just want to clarify that.
You're right, I did state staff, and I'd be fine with it staff, or it could be workshopped as to what's the most appropriate way to determine that. To be honest, I hadn't thought through that aspect of the motion. I thought it would get worked out.
Well, my only concern, and obviously I love staff, but my only concern is that staff has proposed number 10. So if you give an option to staff to pose 10 or an interest rate, they could impose 10, right? Yeah. Should it not be where the applicant has the option to either sit out or pay the capital cost, you know, to get the loan?
Yeah.
Is that?
Looks like Marissa has, before I change anything, it looks like Marissa has something. No?
Latasha.
I agree with Director Fasella that I would expect that it would be a developer choice.
And the way that we would administer that is through the application itself. You can check a box.
Okay, so I'll clarify the amendment to include that the applicant we'll select which one.
We still have a second.
Yeah. We need a second on that.
Yeah. No, I remain a second. And I think what we're trying to accomplish here is we just want to make sure that people are made whole. And I think we're doing that with this motion. So I call the question. Let's do this.
Thank you.
Are we in discussion?
Not if she called the question.
No. I need a second on calling the question.
Let me state that we are not subject to Robert's Rules of Order.
We're not.
And we have used an abbreviated, watered-down version of it to move things along.
Okay.
And so we also are subject to a statute which makes us, in some cases, unable to follow Robert's Rules of Order.
Gotcha.
That being said, right now we have a motion from Mr. Motwani. We've had discussion. We've had a second. Is there any more discussion? Ms. Shrine would like us to have a vote.
Yes.
Okay.
Question.
Yeah.
Director Green Cobb, can you confirm that the discussion around the amendment is what you were looking to achieve with your friendly amendment?
Yes, it was.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
Because at this point, there's really no need to go back to my motion, which
right.
was my point, and why you really shouldn't voted on
that's
that
what
because
I was
it was
clarify.
On the floor.
No.
So that should have fallen. It should have been voted against.
Okay. Yeah, I'm sensing the discussion may be winding down to a close, so can we have a vote, please?
All right, all in favor of the
amendment.
Aye. Any opposed?
Mr. Chairman, I move the recommendation as amended.
Okay. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a lot of seconds. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
None. Motion passes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, parliamentarian, for keeping us straight.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
Would you indulge an old guy and call a five-minute break, please, sir?
Who's the old guy?
I was looking out for you, Mr. Chairman.
Please be quick.
Five-minute break.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Okay, well, that should be the most, that should be the most controversial items.
I didn't expect that.
All right, we're going to go ahead and get started as soon as we can find Trey. Anybody see the executive director?
Huh? We're back?
No, we're waiting on the executive director.
Oh, Holly's in the back.
No.
Just hit the go.
We lost Trey.
He is not lost.
We don't need him?
These are hopefully non-controversial items.
Okay.
Yeah.
We got through the comment portion.
Yeah. We're done with the...
Okay. Are we on professional services?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Finally.
Finally. That's right.
Okay. We'll go ahead and move on to professional services. That's you, Laura.
It is. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
You're welcome.
In June, you authorized the solicitation to procure one or more management companies to handle the daily operations of a property after we take title any multifamily developments through foreclosure. A request for qualifications was issued and one response was received from Royal American Management, Inc. Each member of the review committee individually reviewed the proposal submitted and their final scores are provided in Exhibit B. The review committee recommends that the board authorize Florida Housing to enter into contract negotiations with Royal American Management, Inc.
So move.
Second.
I have a motion and second. Any discussion? I see none. We're all tired, I guess. Okay. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Seeing none, motion passes.
Thank you.
Okay. Next, we have Bill. You're
yes,
up.
Thank you very much. I'll be presenting today on the action item under 7B, which is request for qualifications, RFQ 2021-04 for technical assistance provider services. Last June, the board authorized staff to issue a competitive solicitation. In this case, it was a request for qualifications to search for and select technical assistance providers services. We primarily use this technical assistance providers for services related to providing technical assistance and education for the participants in our pre-development loan program. But we also use the technical assistance providers for providing those services to applicants in demonstrations as well as other special projects. At that time, the board authorized the executive director to establish a review committee to make a recommendation to the board regarding the selection by the review committee for the requests for qualifications proposals. The request for qualifications was issued on June 22nd, 2021. A copy of the request for qualifications is an exhibit in your package, Exhibit C. One response was received by the submission deadline, and that response or proposal came from the Florida Housing Coalition, Inc. Each of the three review committee members individually reviewed and scored the submitted proposal. The review committee provided final scores for the response at the review committee meeting on August 5th. The score sheet is also provided as Exhibit B in your package. As a recommendation, the review committee recommended that the board authorize Florida Housing Coalition, Inc., or Florida Housing, to enter into a contract with Florida Housing Coalition, Inc., and that the board authorize staff to issue a new competitive solicitation process so we may increase the pool of providers for the technical assistance services.
OK. Okay, I have a recommendation. Do I have a motion?
So moved. Second.
Okay, second. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Seeing none, motion passes. Next, we have Marissa.
Thank you. This item is the contract renewal recommendation for our capital needs assessment provider services. The board authorized our us to enter into contract negotiations with the firm set forth in your materials in September 2018. And as a part of those contracts, contingent upon satisfactorily performing their obligations, Florida Housing may renew those contracts for an additional 3-year period. We support using this 3-year renewal option for all 7 contracts and recommend you to proceed to direct us to proceed with those renewals. Thank you.
Okay.
Move the recommendation.
Second.
Yep. Motion and a second. Discussion. Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Any opposed? Nope. Motion carries. Okay. That's it, right?
Next is home buyer loan.
Oh.
Angie?
Yes.
Do I have that? No, we don't. Okay, see, Angie.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This item authorizes Florida Housing to sell single-family bonds in 2022. As you know, we sell bonds under 2 single-family master indentures, and both are rated AAA. We have 3 ways to settle loans that are originated in our home buyer loan program: the TBA market, the specified pool market, or in bonds. We look at all 3 options when it comes time, and we use a best execution model, so we settle the securities where it makes the most financial sense. We expect to continue to use all 3, but of course, we don't know exactly what the markets are going to look like next year. Today, we're requesting approval to issue up to $450 million in bonds, and we have enough carry forward bond allocation to cover that. We have just under $40 million in bonds that may be optionally refunded next year. Depending on bond market conditions, it may make sense to do that. But if it doesn't, we could issue the full $450 million in new money bonds. The resolution includes authorization to utilize assets related to the indenture to purchase loans prior to issuance and to cover any negative arbitrage. Because issuing bonds is a fairly lengthy process, we come to you fairly early in this year to go forward with next year's authorization. We have to get authorization from the State Board of Administration, so we have to time it with the meetings that they have for the rest of this year. So staff recommends that the board approve the necessary funding, staff actions, and the resolution to permit the issuance of the proposed 2022 Phase 1 homeowner mortgage revenue bonds.
Second.
I have a second. Okay. All in favor? Oh, discussion. Sorry. Okay. Nothing. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? Seeing none, motion passes. Okay. Public comment. Uh-oh. What does uh-oh mean?
You never know.
Some board member comment, if there is no public comment when you're done, sir.
No public comment. Okay. Board members.
I will be brief, if I may. The homeless school children program, for those of you that are newer to the board, it was launched time frame, I don't know, a couple of years ago, Bill can correct me. Santa Rosa County, we launched it. We deployed to 2 other counties, Charlotte and Bay. Thank you, and Hernando. Program that I thought is awesome. We take families, for those of you that are newer, identified by school board officials or school officials, where they identify homeless kids in the school. Set up a program for them to get an apartment, fund that, and work to sustaining on their own. So, great program, but now with COVID and also with increases in rents, which I think federal government came out and said 2% is the increase in rents. That's absolutely absurd. They would even consider saying that when we know it's 10% plus. They are being priced out, given our guidelines, of being able to implement this program. Now, temporarily, there's the federal rent subsidy, which is going to have the duration of COVID, except I'm worried that new kids aren't getting in. We talked specifically about Charlotte County, where the average rent is much higher than what we are able to implement. And I'd just like to know what we can do to bring it back into action. And I'm still very interested in expanding it beyond those counties to more counties, because I think it's a fantastic program.
Bill, you want any comment?
Yes, I think there are a number of challenges right now related to the pandemic. One is just kind of the issue of the school programs and the schools with all their challenges. We also, as Ryan said, we've seen across the board that there's challenges with finding, even though they have the home tenant-based rental assistance through our program, there's a challenge finding rental housing, and not only just in general the rental housing stock, but now as prices are increasing, it's above, say, the fair market rents or the values that we are allowed under the federal home program. So some of the families have been placed, which is good, into other housing with, say, the coronavirus relief or the American Rescue Plan Act funds, but that's a much shorter term, as well as the families don't then go along with the wraparound services that are provided by the community stakeholders. So we're dealing with the challenges as they come, and we are interested. In fact, we are focusing on issuing another request for qualifications in the spring, and right now my staff have been working very closely with the counties who are participating, as well as the counties that are interested, the next time around, and kind of addressing what are those challenges, and working not only with the school districts but the public housing authorities who are key members, case management organizations, and then just in general the key local partners. And as you can imagine, it's kind of distinct. Some of the issues are distinct in each of the counties.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. You know, we drive 3 or 4 hours each way for these meetings, and usually the meetings last, exception is today, an hour and a half. I think we're missing an opportunity to be more proactive and productive, to be able to have a conversation amongst ourselves at the end of a meeting, formalize it by making an agenda item, and maybe even afford a member an opportunity to bring up an issue. There's a lot out there. This is affordable housing is a rapidly changing landscape. There are numerous issues that I was told today, for instance, about one person told me about advancing a project where they were faced with $1 million worth of impact fees. I mean, there's so many things out there that affect affordable housing that are not being addressed or not being discussed, and even more input from those people that we're serving, in effect. I just would like to see us maybe get involved in a little more discussion. If I'm going to drive 3 or 4 hours each way, why not make part of it, make use of that time? And that's my comment, Mr. Chairman.
Makes sense to me.
Okay. Well.
Okay. Good.
Since I don't control the agenda, I assume that means an acquiescence to what I'm suggesting here, right?
It does.
Yes. Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
I have a couple of items. I'll bring up the next one.
Okay. Do we need to limit your time?
That's your prerogative, Mr. Chairman. You are the chair.
So the answer is yes.
I have a couple of announcements.
Okay. Any other board member?
I would like to make a comment. So I do once again thank staff for all that you guys do in order to inform us of what we can and cannot do and how things will be projected forward. So just thank you for all the information.
Thank you. And Mr. Chairman, so I didn't know if we had any other elected officials join us. This would be a great opportunity for them to come up and introduce yourself. I don't know if Representative Cheney has made it in the room yet.
Well, she says she's here.
She's here, but I don't see her. She's probably in the hotel. A couple of things I can stall for time. To talk about the next meeting will be in Panama City, God willing. This is the
This is the meeting that, quite frankly, we've had issues with.
For 3 years.
For 3 years. It will coincide with roughly the 3-year anniversary of Hurricane Michael, when we should have been in Panama City. Then the hotel still wasn't ready in 2019. Then 2020, some other little thing happened that you probably recall. So we're going for 2021. I would say, I know it's probably Adam and the secretary and us at Florida Housing that have the shortest drive. Now that board member Dubuque has retired off the board, we do hope to see him. But I will tell you that I think we'll have a filled day the day before the board meeting on Thursday. I think that's October 21st. I don't have the calendar in front of me, but that's roughly what we're talking about. I think we're going to see some of the fruits of our labor and board meetings. I think we'll see openings and or near completed construction of units that are that have come sprung out of the Hurricane Michael RFA. So that's exciting. We hope to also visit some with the state CFO, Jimmy Petronas, who is, you know, from Panama City as well. So we'll plan to hopefully see him that evening over at Captain Anderson's. So we'll be working on that and just want you to make plans. And it might make more sense for some of you to have a hotel room Wednesday night as well, because we're probably going to get started. Of course, they are in a different time zone. Don't forget that. They're in Central Time. So with that, I just want to make that announcement so that you all are ready for hopefully what is a fulfilling board meeting and experience in Panama City. So, and then with that, I understand Representative Linda Cheney is here. If she'd like to come forward and address the board, we appreciate you being here, Representative. Thank you. And I have not had the opportunity to meet the representative yet, but I understand she's also recently been placed, I think, on most, if not all, the committees of substance that Florida Housing sees before the legislature. So congratulations on that, and we look forward to hearing from you.
Hello, everyone. I guess my back is going to be to somebody, no matter.
Yeah, that's pretty much how it's going to be.
Where I do this, so I'll go around this way. I am Linda Cheney. I am House Representative for District 69, which is South Pinellas Beaches. Very heavy tourism area, so we've got a lot of workforce housing issues. I was a city commissioner in that area over 10 years ago. And that was the issue and the challenge. We're a built-out community, so the challenge of redeveloping to accommodate the needs of the tourism industry, including their workforce housing, remains a challenge. And we in the legislature are all aware of this and aware of the need. What we don't have is real easy solutions, but we do, you know, we're with you in finding solutions. Anything else you think I should address?
No, I think that's great. I think, you know, and I don't know if the board members have any questions. I saw that I believe you were just recently appointed to the Tourism and Infrastructure Appropriations Subcommittee, which is where you'll see the Sadowski funds and those issues come before you. So appreciate any support you can give us there.
Absolutely. Yeah, I was on that committee my first session. I am a freshman, and the speaker appointed me as vice chair of that committee this session.
Oh, congratulations. That's
yeah,
great.
Thank you. So he's got a lot of confidence in me, and he understands the importance and the importance to me in my district. Yeah,
thank you, ma'am. Thank we look you. Forward to working with you in the coming session.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, anything else?
And don't go anywhere. We also have to really quickly convene for Florida Housing 3.
Yes. So. Motion to adjourn and a motion to
reconvene. She's got to do a call order.
Motion. Oh, call. Yeah.
Yep. A call to order.
Call to order. I want
for Florida Housing 3.
Is.
Yep.
Okay. All right. I'll go ahead and call the meeting to order. For Florida Housing 3, and I need an approval of the minutes.
Actually, we need to call to order and roll call.
Oh, roll Sorry. Call.
Yep.
Okay. It's not on there.
Ron Lieberman.
Here.
Latasha Green-Cobb.
Present.
Ryan Benson.
Here.
Sandra Einhorn.
Here.
Mario Ficella.
Here.
Bill Gulliford.
Here.
Dev Matwani.
Here.
Holly Rashine.
Here.
Adam Calloway.
Here.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. All right, now I need approval of the minutes.
So move.
Second.
I have motion and second. Any discussion? Seeing none, All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any public comment? Seeing none?
Wait, oh, we have a comment.
He couldn't. See, I was out of the room before, but I flipped the page and I saw, oh, there's public comment.
Okay. Public comment over.
Sir, good morning. Sean Wilson, Blue Sky Communities. As a vocal proponent of some sort of viability loan program over the summer, spring and summer, I wanted to express my appreciation to staff and the board for coming forward with that program now. And I thought the discussion today on the where you guys wound up was great. It was a really interesting discussion. This is really turning into a strong board, and do appreciate everything. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Sean.
Thank you.
Okay. Nothing else? We'll go ahead and call the meeting.
There you go.
All right. Thank you. Yep.
Go.
Bang it.
It's over.
Adjourned.
It's over.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you, everyone. Safe travels. Okay.
Over.
What did we discuss?
We just had to approve the
matter. Do I have-